Yo, all black, everything, polo and socks. Symbolize we not defeated by them system and cops. Word or not.
Thinking about the absence of World War I in how we think and write about American history, but more specifically, the absence of African Americans in that story, right? So thinking about the significance of the World War I era for African Americans, for peoples of African descent more broadly, and then thinking very specifically about the role of black soldiers, both in terms of their service, but also their symbolism, what they represented. In what ways were African American soldiers really encapsulating these struggles, these contentious debates about the very meaning of democracy itself? In which way did their service stake claim to a type of citizenship, a type of manhood that African Americans were striving for in the context of the war era, but also how were they used kind of symbolically, rhetorically, for broader struggles for black freedom and equality during the World War I era more broadly? The Civil War is really important because this was really the formative period in thinking about certainly the black military experience, right. The role of African Americans in the Union Army, close to 200,000 serving exploits of Massachusetts 54, but also how that leads into the direct formation of a type of African-American citizenship. So we see African-Americans like W.E.B. Du Bois, other black leaders who are very explicitly hearkening back to the Civil War and Reconstruction era and thinking about World War I as the next step in this journey, this quest for African-American citizenship, and how military service, how these heroic exploits on the battlefield, shedding blood, engaging in this kind of ultimate sacrifice as citizens is going to be the key, the linchpin for African Americans staking claim to their citizenship. For those black folks who traveled overseas, roughly 200,000 African Americans fight and labor in France. That was a remarkable experience. The idea of a sharecropper from rural Alabama going to France for the first time in his life, crossing the Atlantic, interacting with white folks who have a different sensibility about race, interacting with African soldiers.
While they're in segregated barracks when they're back in the U.S.
So these disconnects between the realities of white supremacy kind of transported from the United States to France and this idea of a different set of possibilities is transformative. And they bring that back with them to the United States. So these men are returning with a different type of consciousness, racial, political. They're thinking about themselves, their families, employment opportunities, their lives in very different ways. And that was incredibly powerful for African Americans, both North and South. That manifested itself in a number of different ways. We have a lot of returning soldiers who just want to try and go back and live their lives as best they could. You have others who leave the South, who migrate to the North. You have others who translate their experiences into direct forms of political activism and radical organization, whether it's in the UNIA, right, Marcus Garvey. He's very explicitly calling for black veterans to come join the UNIA.
And he's using, invoking the military regalia.
The symbolism, the pageantry, right? I mean, this is kind of seen as another form of service for these veterans as they're being kicked out of the U.S. Army after the war. So you have a number of other organizations running the ideological spectrum from the Urban League, the NAACP, through the African Blood Brotherhood and the Communist Party. So we see kind of the reverberations of the black military experience for all aspects of black political culture.
All black, you know, all black in the name of all my black heroes, all black everything, all black polos, all black medallions, yeah, all black, you know, say all black everything, all black, you know.